The following program is a repeat telecast.
Mr. William Kunstler is perhaps the best known of the lawyers who have identified themselves with the cause of dissent. He is the only lawyer whose activities persuaded a candidate for the United States Senate that justice would be advanced by disbarring him. Indeed, a bill has been introduced in Congress which would empower United States attorneys to bring disbarment proceedings against the likes of Mr. Kunstler, assuming there is such a thing as the likes of Mr. Kunstler, in the absence of which assumption it will no doubt be suggested that my brother is attempting a bill of attainder. Mr. Kunstler began his hectic career at Yale University, where he wrote his first underground tract, a book called Our Pleasant Vices. He served in the Second World War, was decorated, went to the law school at Columbia University, taught English, founded a firm with his brother, has lectured and taught law, and along about 1961 was radicalized after surveying the civil rights struggle in the South. He has written 8 books, delivered 1,000 lectures, and burned down who knows how many buildings. In a speech a year or so ago in Washington, D.C., Mr. Kunstler said, quote, "There isn't anything that's going to change anything in this country unless the people are in the street." I should like to begin by asking Mr. Kunstler whether in giving that advice he was acting as a lawyer or other than as a lawyer.
Well, before you begin, Mr. Buckley, I just want to indicate that your introduction is, seems to me, somewhat unfair, but since it's your battlefield and you control it, I'll just make that comment and pass on to...
Well, I'd rather you indicated the unfairness of it. I'd be more...
Well, I think to introduce a guest with the statement, burn down Lord knows how many buildings, when there isn't a shred of evidence as to one, I think it's somewhat unfair and gives a misleading impression of me to the general public. I'm your guest, and I think that an introduction of me should be at least within the civility of host-guest and not be inaccurate or even misleading.
Well, you're here as my adversary, not so much as my guest. You certainly...
I know, but I don't get the chance to introduce you, you see.
Well, go ahead. Talk for a while about it.
No, I think that I'm going to accept it as it is because I try not to deal in personalities and rarely have. And as you know, we've met before and I've tried to stay away from this. You frequently deal in personalities. Mm-hmm. And therefore, I think it would be a sort of...
I deal in people.
Well, people and personalities, we'll put it that way.
Yeah.
Now, you asked me a question which I've forgotten in our interchange. Could you repeat it?
Sure. The question is, when you say that no change is going to come about unless people are in the street, were you acting as a lawyer or were you acting as a, other than as a lawyer?
Well, I can't remember where I said that. It sounds like something I might well have said. Mm-hmm. And I have two lives, as I guess you do too, and so does everyone else, if not more. One of them is as an attorney in a courtroom. The other is as a human being, a political being, a person who is moved by the events of his time and comments on them. And I was saying that, I think, as my profound belief that all progress, whether it be in the United States or anywhere else, is ultimately engineered by the pressure of people. And when I say people in the streets, that's a wide area, of course. It means people
as distinguished,
picketing.
As distinguished in personalities?
No, I don't think we could even semanticize it, even for the sake of a quip here and there. Mm-hmm. I think that what it is human beings in the street, human beings who are picketing, demonstrating, dissenting, and that has been the way, I think, of all social progress in every country. We're not the only country, of course, where that has occurred.
Well, now, what kind of picketing, for instance, was it that resulted in, Social Security legislation?
Well, Social Security legislation is certainly progress. I think you will recall that prior to the enactment of the Social Security law, there were demonstrations, I think, in over 50 cities where people picketed federal courthouses and federal buildings urging passage of the Social Security law. In fact, I can recall one of old people marching here in New York for the Social Security legislation. I don't say that every piece of legislation requires people in the streets. I don't say every ounce of human progress is measured by significant climactic things like the end of slavery, the end of racism, the end of war. These are more than frequently engineered by the power of people.
Where has the end of racism been engineered?
Well, it hasn't taken place yet, but that doesn't stop people, of course,
but when it
from
happens,
demonstrating.
Well, in other words, when you say people in the streets, all you simply mean is people people indicating what their preferences are. That's what
Well, no, it's more than that. People can indicate preferences by voting at a ballot box. That's mm-hmm. one way. Mm-hmm. They can indicate preferences by writing to a congressman. Mm-hmm. They can do what Martin Luther King did and fill the jails of Birmingham. They can do what the colonials did in 1772, I believe, and dump tea in Boston Harbor. They can chain themselves to federal courthouses the way the suffragettes did. They can demonstrate as the bonus marches did before they were dispelled by General MacArthur in the streets of Washington. All sorts of mechanisms.
Shooting people is another way of doing it, of course.
Certain people?
Yeah.
Well, when groups are in the streets, they are, of course, certain people. They're people who are vitally interested in what's happening.
Sure, sure. Sirhan certainly expressed his preferences.
Well, now you're making a kind of a ridiculous example. I'm not advocating the assassination of Bobby Kennedy. That isn't a demonstration.
I'm not saying
know that
you
too.
Are. I'm not saying that you are.
You're picking an outlandish example and using that to make my example seem outlandish itself.
Well, there's plenty of time for you to suggest whether or not what you say is outlandish or not. So don't be in a hurry about it.
No, I'm in no hurry.
I'm anxious to make distinctions, as Bobby Seale says. I'm anxious to make distinctions here.
Yeah, but don't make invidious ones that are not analogous.
Well, now wait a minute. Why is it? All right, let's get back to the genus express preferences, right? I said express preferences. You said to me no.
Well, not only preferences, grievances.
That's right.
Dissent.
That's right. Now, there are ways that express preferences from writing a personal letter to your congressman to, say, assassinating somebody.
No, I don't think assassinating
Therefore,
anybody
there is a distinction. Where do we draw the line?
Between that's legal and illegal? Against a human
between
being.
Legal and illegal?
No, it's not even between illegal and legal. I am in favor of some illegal demonstrations. Mm-hmm. The Boston Tea Party was wholly illegal, and the suffragettes were illegal.
By definition, revolutions are illegal.
Well, but that was before the revolution. That was in 1772, I believe.
Well, it was part of the revolutionary movement.
Well, it was part of a protest movement against the King of England.
Yeah, but it was certainly legal. I don't doubt that. Now,
killing a human being is not legal and not moral, whether it's done in Vietnam today or whether it's done in the Roosevelt Hotel in Los Angeles.
I don't think that's necessarily true.
Well, I think killing in Vietnam is immoral.
It seems to me the execution,
and illegal.
The execution of Eichmann was not, in my judgment, an immoral thing to do.
Are we talking about the execution of Eichmann, a man who was convicted
killing.
Of a crime?
You said killing.
Well, we're talking about different things now. So you like to make analogies that are not analogies, and I'm going to resist them throughout this program.
Well, I wish you the best of luck.
Thank you.
Yeah, I think it is, though, important for you to understand that when you make some of your statements, which have caused you to be a very well-known and very controversial public figure, it's precisely because some people understand you to be urging certain kinds of activity, which are, quote, illegal. Now, you say you don't deny this.
No, well, I don't deny it.
You want to distinguish between the kind of activities which are illegal, which you approve of, and the kind of activities which are illegal, which you disapprove of. Correct.
Okay. Yeah, but I want to tell you one thing. First of all, I do not urge people to take actions which are legal or illegal. In fact, I don't urge people really to do things. I urge people to think of their consciences, think of what they want to do, think of all the possibilities involved, and then I tell every single audience, you be your own guide. Nobody can lead you, not a Bill Buckley or a Bill Kunstler. Mm-hmm. But you be your own guide, draw your own conscience definitions, and act accordingly. I do say that I do not countenance violence against a human being or in any way against property that would injure the life of a human being or the person of a human being.
Mm-hmm. Well, when you said in Chicago, you must learn to fight in the streets, learn to revolt, learn to shoot guns. You meant shoot them in the air, is that it?
I don't think I said that in Chicago.
Well, do you remember where you said it?
I don't remember where I said it or if I said it.
Did you write a protest against the editorial that quoted you as having said it?
I think it's wrong. I don't remember ever saying a statement like that.
We will learn to do
guns.
All the things the
that
poverty
That was Tom Hayden's
fear.
Speech at Chicago, as I recall.
Oh, was it? Was it Tom Hayden's?
I think it's Tom Hayden's recorded speech played during the trial.
Oh, it is?
Yeah, so I think if you attribute things to me, they should be mine.
Well, all right. They, I agree with you. In other words, you disavow that statement.
It's Tom Hayden's speech.
I said you disavow
no,
it.
No, I don't disavow anything anybody says. Every man is his own conscience.
You don't disavow what the head of the Ku Klux Klan says?
If he wants to say it, let him say it. I may oppose it. I may argue against it. but it's his right to say it.
Now tell me,
what is it that makes you reject the word disavow?
Why are you so afraid of the word disavow?
Not afraid.
I can see why those judges had such a long trial.
Why do you object to the word disavow?
Did
I quiver in fear at the word disavow?
Yes, you did. Right. You said, I don't disavow anything.
Must have some meter here that shows my quivering reaction.
What your reaction is obvious.
Well,
you do or do not disavow that statement?
I disavow, if you want to use the word disavow. There are many things that Tom Hayden says with which I do not agree with.
Would you give me an example?
Well, I'll use this very speech that you're talking about. If Tom Hayden said it's time to get guns, and I thought there was no reason at that moment for getting guns, I would disavow it. I don't know the circumstances. I think there are times to get guns. I think there are times when people need self-defense. Mm-hmm. I don't know in what circumstances Tom said that.
Well, if you get guns, it's to shoot people, right?
Well, I do that in Vietnam, of course.
Now, wait a minute. You don't like Vietnam, though.
I don't like
Vietnam. Well, then, why do you bring in Vietnam?
Because you're using the word guns as a scare tactic. If a person is to be murdered in the streets by an assassin like Martin Luther King, I would have willingly had seen someone shoot down that assassin.
Okay, so therefore, it is not...
Self-defense.
All right, self-defense.
I think that's the only time I would advocate the use of any weapon.
It's self-defense. But you definitely advocate for self-defense.
Yes,
you understand its use.
I think the Second Amendment to the United States Constitution ensures that. And every state provides that as a legitimate defense to a murder prosecution.
That's correct. Now, when you were being questioned recently.
You realize that's the first time you've agreed with me.
Ask me. My quivering has stopped. Ask me when the date is, and maybe I'll agree with you. Now, you said it to an interviewer from Playboy magazine that it is the role of the American left to resist rather than merely protest, to resist the legitimate authority. Then they went on to say, well, what is the legitimate authority? And you said, well, the authority that ordains, quotes, the draft, any payment of taxes to support the war in Vietnam, the domestic and foreign policies of a government that crushes people on every level, all the things of this society that tend to degrade and destroy people. Therefore, as I understand it, you're saying that any authority that is responsible for any situation in America that relates to our foreign or domestic policy is a legitimate authority, and therefore it's all right to resist it. Is that
correct? No, not any authority. See, you're widening it and broadening it.
Well, that relates to those four descriptions.
Well, let me take those four. I think that the draft to use young men in an illegal, unconstitutional, immoral war in Vietnam should be resisted. Mm-hmm. If I were of draft age, I would not go into the army. I would resist. I don't know what form I would take at this moment because I'm well past that stage. But I would resist. I think it is illegal and it is wrong and immoral for young men to be drafted for that war and that they should resist it. I also say that this is not an urging on my part because I don't think that I should urge people to do things. I think people have to come to their own realization in their own good conscience of what they do.
Are you saying that you're not going to urge somebody to resist the draft who doesn't want to resist the draft? I mean, in other words, you concede the freedom not to resist
the draft. I don't urge those who don't want to resist or do resist. I point out, just as I'm pointing out to you, what my feelings are about the draft. If a thinking human being listens to me, and in the process of his thought,
it's not your feelings.
Comes to the conclusion that he ought to do that, that is his decision. Many do not, and many will not.
Well, Mr. Kunstler, what's interesting, frankly, is not your views on Vietnam. It's your views on how the war against Vietnam, if you want to call it that, should be pressed. This is really what brings you here and what has made you particularly interesting, because here you are saying that the domestic and foreign policies of a government that crushes people at every level, that's us.
Well, I don't think it's you particularly.
Or brought about by illegitimate authority, see? Now, illegitimate authority therefore means the laws passed by the Congress of the United States, which is responsible for the existing situation. Therefore, you call the laws passed by Congress an illegitimate authority.
Well,
now, why don't you face up to the consequences of what you write?
Well, Sam Adams said the laws passed by Parliament were illegitimate authority and urge people to resist them.
What does Sam Adams have to do with this discussion?
Everything.
Oh, he does?
Because Sam Adams...
Then anything that Sam Adams thought was correct, we ought to believe
no,
was correct.
No, but anything that Sam Adams wanted to speak about and wanted to urge in a system which he thought was oppressing American citizens. Mm-hmm. That analogy is the same today. Protest and resistance to oppression is the same, whether you take it in the time of the trial of Jesus, who went through the same ordeal, or Socrates, or Sam Adams, or H. Rapp Brown. It's all the same.
What is legitimate authority?
Well, I think legitimate or illegitimate authority is something that people have to determine for themselves. I don't think there's any handbook that says this is illegitimate authority or this is legitimate authority. You make conscience determinations for yourself, and so do I. And I think we live by them.
Well, all right, let me give you an example. Suppose Congress passes a law saying there's to be a minimum wage of $1.75, and Employer Jones says he disagrees with that, and therefore it's illegitimate. He only wants to pay $1.65. Is Mr. Jones entitled to proceed to disobey that law?
That, I might suggest, is a ridiculous example. Well, and I'll tell you why. Let me finish. I'll tell you why. Because people don't go into the streets, bands of employers, because there's a difference as to minimum wage. We're talking about fundamental things. Oppression of black people, oppression of Chicanos and Puerto Ricans, oppression of GIs who fight in Vietnam, oppression of the Vietnamese. We're talking about life and death situations, slavery, all of these things that go to the human spirit. I think that to talk about, with your example of a band of employers going into the streets, they could do it, of course. But I don't think that's a realistic example. Give more an example of black people in Selma wanting to vote. That would be a more realistic example.
What you are simply saying is that those examples are all legitimate, of which you happen to consider grave.
No, I think the manufacturers are legitimate too if they want to do that, but it's not a realistic example in today's world to think we're talking about manufacturers in the street. That just isn't going to happen. I think you know it and I know it.
The whole purpose of attempting to draw out a position, Mr. Kunstler, is to see how he would apply it other than in ways in which he finds it fashionable.
I know, but you've got to make the analogies parallel or at least reasonably similar. That's all I'm asking.
All right, suppose Congress passes a law saying that beyond a certain level, you have to pay a 90% tax. Now, some people, presumably those who pay the 90% tax, would consider that very reasonable. Is that a legitimate law? Is that a legitimate authority who passed that law?
Well, I'm saying the same thing with that I said with the other. I think if they really feel that that is illegitimate, both the manufacturers in your example, first one, and the 90% millionaires in the second example, see, you stick to manufacturers and millionaires. And that's a different...
Sure, because I'm telling
not
you...
Not a category I'm used to.
That's right. I'm showing you how capitalists can use your arguments
right.
to their benefit.
Well, that's perfectly all right. Yeah. They can demonstrate. If I would stand here and say that the manufacturer...
No, I didn't say demonstrate.
...couldn't go in the street.
I said that they
could
would...
Could
regard
it as illegitimate, yes.
Yes, they could therefore disappear.
Yeah. And you've had people do that. I think Ms. Kellams refuses, and she is a...
Yeah, she tries...
She's a neighbor of yours, isn't she?
She's trying a constitutional test case,
Right.
That's right. I like these non-invidious...
Non-invidious
nice, legitimate analogies.
No, but I knew you knew her, you see.
Yes, of course I know her. I'm very glad to know her. The question is the individual, depending on whether or not he believes the gravity of the offense is sufficient to entice him to do so, free to consider the Congress of the United States and the courts a, quote, illegitimate authority?
Yes.
To use your term.
He is, but I think that when you reduce it to one individual with one grievance, you get into maybe it's legitimate, and I would say it was, but you get into the eccentric class, which I would class Ms. Kellams as somewhat in the eccentric class. Eccentric in that she is kind of a single individual fighting a single personal grievance. Not that she herself is eccentric, but I don't know her as well as you do. But the when you get into large social movements, I think that's a more reasonable comparison, where you get millions or hundreds and thousands of people who have the same type of grievance. That's a different area. And I think that though the rules are the same, I agree with you. I think you're in a much more realistic area when you start talking about people protesting the war or protesting the treatment of Angela Davis or protesting what happened to the Panthers here in this city, being held in jail 2 years and then acquitted of 156 counts of conspiracy in 90 minutes by a jury. When you get into those things where hundreds and thousands of people have much the same grievance, then I think you're in the area in which I live most of the time. I'm not in the rarefied area of one or two or 100 having a grievance. Although I agree, the rules would be much the same.
All right. Therefore, if I understand you, you are saying that it is exclusively in the authority of an individual having surveyed the law to decide the extent to which, because it impinges on what it is that he wants to do, whether or not it is legitimate or illegitimate, and if he considers that it is illegitimate, he is therefore free to proceed to violate it, as he will not only free, but in fact, I understand that you enjoin this as the highest form of moral conduct, correct?
No, well, I haven't said it's the highest form of moral conduct. I haven't made degrees of moral conduct, but my answer is yes,
okay, fine.
Because that, I think, is a thorough tradition in American life. Thoreau refused to pay what you would call a legitimate exercise of the Massachusetts legislature establishing a poll tax.
Yeah.
He broke that law and went to jail. Yeah. And that is regarded as a high moral act.
Gandhi broke
the law of India, and Gandhi went to jail. We have many people here in the United States who have done exactly the same thing. Eugene Debs went to jail.
Fine, splendid.
Now, when you say fine, splendid, I get the feeling you don't really believe it's fine, splendid.
Well, no, we'll get to that. Now, in that same interview in Playboy, you were asked to be specific about how certain reforms could be ventured. And you said, well, take the students. The students can take over their college by occupying its buildings. And then the question said, well, if the administration refuses to grant the students' demands, what should they do? And you said they should move one step further. You said, quote, another form of resistance would be to take, would be to burn down the building at a, to burn down a particular college building. Now, this startled the questioner in Playboy, and he said, you condone arson, to which you replied, yes. If a point has been reached in a given situation where the mechanisms of society are not responding to serious grievances. Now, these are not words considering which you have any reservations at all, or are they now?
No, but I'd like to tell you that he asked me of certain examples of protest, and I gave him one more, which you haven't gotten to. I said it could revolt, too.
Mm-hmm.
It could go into full-scale revolution. And you didn't read the next thing after my arson. I said Hiroshima was a pretty good example of arson. And I take it you must have approved of that.
Well, again, that's a
well, the point is, you say if it's approved, but if a student does it, it's something else.
Mr. Kunstler,
I don't like either one.
Can I proceed on the assumption that you can distinguish between a declaration of war passed by both houses of Congress, pursued in an attempt to save the world from the Axis powers, to defend the Jewish population of Germany to the extent that it could be done, to save people from the Axis aggressions against China, that you can distinguish between that and somebody burning down a building in protest against the social policies of building a gymnasium in that university?
Is that a distinction that's abiding in your mind? You usually don't help me so much. You've given me my answer.
Yeah.
Because what you've really said is that under certain circumstances, any form of arson, mayhem, bombing is justifiable. And you've given an example of World War II. And I'm telling you, there are many people in the United States who believe that it's just as justifiable to try to stop the war in Vietnam as it is to prosecute World War II.
Well, I don't deny
that. To stop the Germans from doing the same thing we're doing.
I don't deny this. I'm simply asking you, not other people, I'm asking you whether you can distinguish between the bombing of Hiroshima as a civil act and the burning down of a college building by some people protesting, let's say, ROTC. Can you distinguish or not? Because if not, we are going to have difficulty making...
No, I'll tell you how I can distinguish. I am against both acts. The burning of the building and a college can cause an injury...
I know you're against it. Don't say that
for
the fifth time, will you?
Let me finish.
Can you distinguish?
I'm making a point and you're trying to stop me. You asked me for an answer and I'm struggling mightily here to give you one. To think of one? Yeah. Well, of course. How would I give you an answer if I didn't think of an answer?
Well, you might try thinking.
One talks after thinking.
That's right.
Right. That may not be your
That may not be obvious.
But it's mine. I'm against both acts, as I've indicated.
Yeah.
They both can cause injury to human life.
Yeah, go on.
I think both can be justified to the people that do them. If their belief is strong enough, to them it may be justified. If their belief is strong enough in what they're trying to do. I am sure if we were in Boston in 1772, I know at Faneuil Hall when they deliberated whether to throw the tea in the harbor, many people said what you said. It's not justifiable to destroy property. And yet they voted and they went out of Faneuil Hall and they burnt or threw into the water 342 bales.
There are
motivations that cause people to act.
Yeah, I know that. I know
and
that. Sure.
I know you know
sure.
that, but you're
sure.
in an attempt trying to subvert
don't
it.
Don't think a rapist doesn't know that.
Now, there's one of your great comparisons. We're talking about the war in Vietnam.
It's motivation.
And you're talking about a rapist.
Well, all right.
Now you know that's not legitimate argument.
I will now attempt to say in plainly what you attempted to answer. What you said is that if there is a retroactive vindication of a particular act satisfactory to X number of people, then that act is, as I say, retroactively justified. Thus, it's all right to burn down the building in protest against ROTC in Colombia because, retroactively, the ROTC is allied in some way with the Vietnam effort. You really understand yourself to be making a major statement concerning the war in Vietnam. Now, this point of view, I understand.
I'll buy it for the moment.
Well, you will buy it assuming that you will concede that there is a distinction between Hiroshima and the urging people to burn down whatever buildings they want to burn down.
Well, but nobody has done that. Nobody has urged people to burn down buildings. There have been very few burnt down to start with, but nobody.
Well, that's because not that many people listen to you.
Well, I don't urge them. Yeah. You see, I have never urged a single soul bill to burn a building, to cause one bit of damage that might injure a human being, and you have no examples.
You condone arson? Question mark. Answer: yes.
Under certain circumstances.
Do you know what arson means?
Of
course I... You are a lawyer. Now, arson means burning down a building illegally. All right?
Illegally.
Now, do I have to... that's what arson means.
That's correct. Arson means bombing a building.
You condone arson? Answer, quote, yes. See, the trouble with you is that you get very resentful whenever anybody reminds you of what you say. If I said what you said, I'd feel the same way.
Yeah, well,
but in point of fact,
I won't even
You run around with this bravura statements about revolution, then you come and you say, I've never urged anybody to burn down a building. What in the hell did you say yes to when they asked you, do you condone arson?
Under certain circumstances.
Yeah, obviously I'm certain.
So do you.
Well, you don't, presumably you don't.
Bill, so do you. Are you against the war in Vietnam? There's arson every day there.
You condone arson
when it fits your purpose.
No, you know nothing about the law. You're about to prove it again. What we are doing in Vietnam is not arson.
No, it's legalized.
It may be other things. All right, if it's legalized, then this copes with the problem that we're trying to get to, having to do with the sources of authority, whether or not we are prepared to allow a court and a constitutional system to make the laws, or whether you, with your rampant conscience, ought to make the laws for people. This is the subject before the
now,
house. Now, I want to bring us
not quite
to
the subject,
question.
But go ahead.
Well, we're here to discuss the role of the lawyer. Now,
well, we haven't even gotten to his role yet.
Well, no, but we know about you, and we know about your general attitudes.
Now, you say you know about my general attitude. I am not sure everybody in the room or whoever sees the program understands quite your version of my attitude.
Well, let's say that everybody has listened to you and drawn his own conclusions.
That's fair enough. That I would accept.
Fine. Now, there are, as you know, certain canons to which lawyers are held subject. One of them, canon number one, is listed under the heading, a lawyer should assist in maintaining the integrity and competence of the legal profession. Included in that is the phrase, he should be temperate and dignified, and he should refrain from all illegal and morally reprehensible conduct. Now, to the extent that you answered yes to the question, do you believe in arson, weren't you, in fact, condoning illegal activity? And doesn't that disqualify you under Canon 1 to continue to serve as a lawyer?
Not at all, because first of all, you're saying I'm condoning arson as a way of life. I was asked a question, do you believe in arson? I said yes, under some circumstances. Arson being the general term for burning.
For burning illegally?
For burning illegally, if you want to call it.
I do.
All right, I said that. Canon 1 indicates that my conduct should be free from reprehensible ideas and so on. Mm-hmm. I think I adhere to that. I think under the First Amendment to the Constitution, I have a right to say what's in my mind, and I have a right to speak. And I can tell you, despite all of your brothers urging every other week, that the Bar Association has not seen fit at this moment. Bring me up and answer that question.
I'll
be glad to answer it for them, too.
You know why? I think I know why. I don't know. But I have a letter from Francis Plimpton, who was the former president of the New York City Bar Association. I published it. And he said, I firmly believe that the complaints against Mr. Kunstler are justified. However, I think it would be a mistake to disbar him because it would only make him a martyr. In other words, he believes, at least, that you are, in fact, guilty of violating the professional canons of your profession, but he doesn't want to disbar you because he figures that would make you a more effective revolutionary than you are.
Yeah. Well, if Mr. Plimpton wrote that, I'm sure he did not know you were going to use it publicly, did he? Did you ask him?
Oh, he wrote it and demanded that I publish it
in
his
column. He demanded you publish it?
Yes.
All right.
In fact, I declined. I published it only in National Review.
But
in any case, it's a matter of record. And
that is Mr. Plimpton's viewpoint, of course. Yeah. Mr. Plimpton.
No, but you said, you see, I haven't been disbarred because, in fact, I haven't been guilty.
Yeah, but then Plimpton has no control whatsoever who's disbarred.
There's a committee on grievances
on which he does not sit.
So what?
Which brings out all disbarment proceedings. You could write a complaint to them, as your brother has done, and they have refused to act upon it at this moment.
And I'm giving you a suggestion as to why.
And I would suggest...
See, you conclude that they haven't acted on it because you're not guilty. In fact, the facts speak for themselves, and we have an explanation from a man who served until last year as president of the New York Bar Association saying why, in his opinion, you oughtn't to be disbarred. Not because you don't violate the canons, not because you don't act intemperately, not because you don't speak prejudicially, not because you're not a cinder in the eye of justice, but in point of fact because they figure you'd be a martyr.
Well, if this cinder can reply briefly.
Sure.
At length,
if you prefer.
Well, I can do it briefly. If Mr. Plimpton wrote that, and you're representing to me he did.
You don't think Tom Hayden did?
I don't know. I was thinking of James Buckley.
Been forging his name?
Who knows who did what?
That's right.
How the evil
this would be a cause
works.
For revolution, too. Right. And illegitimate authority.
But the point is, if Mr. Plimpton wrote that.
We should burn down the Senate if he wrote that, huh?
Do you seriously want me to answer that?
Yeah, go ahead.
All right.
Go ahead.
I don't think you really do.
Take as long as you want.
And will you give me as long as I want?
Sure.
All right. I'll give you about 15 minutes and then I'll be done. But all I want to say is if Mr. Plimpton wrote that, I think it was very unfortunate because Mr. Plimpton has not read one word of the Chicago transcript, did not attend one session of the Chicago trial, and I think that the least he should do is to wait until a court, which is presently considering my case, rules, and they will rule sometime in October. I don't think it's really quite cricket, and you know there's another canon of ethics which you might refer Mr. Plimpton to, that he doesn't comment on pending cases affecting other people's right to practice law.
He's not. He just says that the complaints are justified in his opinion. He's got the right of free speech too, doesn't he?
What complaints?
I heard you complain about the behavior of the lawyer in the New Haven case. And the two Panthers who were found guilty and were sentenced to life sentences yesterday. And I heard
one
you complained loudly to 4,000 people about that lawyer's behavior. Why? Because the lawyer had said that the judge had acted fairly. And this terribly disturbed your whole thesis about this being a racist society.
No, that is why I protested.
He
protested, but he may feel that very strongly. And I didn't protest because I didn't think he had the right to say it. Of course he had the right to say it. But I thought that was a remark that I thought should not have been made about a political defendant. I think only the defendant has the right to say.
Maybe he didn't think he was a political defendant.
Well, he does think he's a political defendant.
Who does?
But in any event, that's not the lawyer's role. The client is the one who's being tried, not the lawyer. And I don't think a lawyer should comment on whether a trial was fair or not to his client, particularly when he's going to attack that.
Particularly
when he's attacking the conviction as being unfair. He's going to be arguing before the Supreme Court of Connecticut that his client got an unfair trial. And they're going to throw back in his face his words that he got a fair trial. That's happened to many lawyers in the past.
Well,
it didn't help the client one whit. It got the lawyer back into good graces of society.
To the extent, Mr. Kunstler, that it was a political trial, precisely his saying that he had been fairly tried is a contribution to the social tranquility, which presumably we were all entitled to. Nobody would know better than the guy who's defending the client. Whether or not the judge acted fairly, because you prefer to call him a fascist and all those words are used by Judge Kaufman down in Chicago.
Bill Buckley, if you will show me one single piece of any transcript in any court in the United States where I have ever called a judge a single name in my life, I would like to see it. You know you haven't seen it. Now, did you ever see that?
Did I ever see what?
Did you ever see a single transcript or hear that I had called any judge a fascist?
Most of the time, I don't know what you're saying because I have to...
Bill, answer my question.
Because the printers have to use so many asterisks when they quote you.
I'm going to pin you down. You've just made a statement in front of these people about me professionally that I called a judge a fascist. I'm asking you to prove it. If you can put it up, you ought to prove it.
Whatever you call the
judge... Can you prove it, Bill?
I haven't got the transcript, and you know I don't have the transcript.
Well, then how can you say it if you haven't read the transcript?
Because I can say it without any difficulty at all.
Oh, I know you can. I should withdraw my last statement. You can say it very easily.
Wait a minute. Because after all, you have been talking about how the whole of the court system is completely shot through with the racism and fascism and so on and so forth, it would obviously follow that people who administered that court system were also shot through with the same diseases. Does
well,
that not follow?
Is that how you're drawing the conclusion that I called
sure,
someone a fascist?
Of course it is. Of course,
Bill,
it is.
That really doesn't become you.
And all right, let me ask you this. Did you do anything to restrain your clients from calling the judges the names you call them?
No, I didn't restrain a single client because I don't think I have an obligation to do so.
Isn't that supposed to be the traditional responsibility?
No, I don't think so.
Well, it is in the opinion of most judges.
Well, it may be in the opinion of most judges, but I'll tell you this: if I thought clients were justified,
You mean you thought the seal was justified in calling the judge a fascist?
Yes,
but you wouldn't
I
do it
did.
Yourself.
Yes, I did. He wasn't doing to me. He didn't bind and gag me.
I see. No, in other words, he was acting as your ventriloquist.
No,
but you didn't want to do it yourself.
Bill, he was a proud black man who was saying what was in his heart. And when I saw him bound and gagged in an American courtroom for wanting nothing
Why
more
was he bound and
than
gagged?
Defend himself.
Why was he bound and
because
gagged?
Because he only wanted to do what William Penn wanted to do,
and the
defend
judge,
himself.
And the judge refused?
The judge refused,
and then
he
what?
Stood up on every occasion in a very decorous fashion for 3 weeks and said, whenever there was an opportunity, I'd like to cross-examine this witness. I'd like to object to that evidence. Finally, the judge threw him in his seat with marshals, bound and gagged him.
Well,
Said he was a fascist pig.
Is it your opinion that the judge did or did not have the right there and then to decide whether a particular motion was to be granted?
No, he didn't have the right.
Constitutionally,
he didn't. Constitutionally, everyone is given the absolute right to defend themselves.
Well, in the first place,
provided they do so before trial.
Not true.
Which it is true.
On a court of appeals case 2 years earlier, a judge refused to grant somebody the right to defend himself
on
the ground
did
that he was clearly incapacitated to do so.
All right,
he was sustained by the Supreme Court.
If you find a man is mentally incompetent, that may be another matter. That was not true of Bobby Seale. There was no finding of that.
Well, we don't know what the judge's finding was. At least
there
I
was none. He just said sit down.
But all right, now if he said sit down, the answer is that he's supposed to sit down, and then you appeal it constitutionally. And then the higher court knocks the head off of Judge Hoffman.
No, he did
but you
sit
don't,
down, Bill.
You don't. You just finished telling us that every few minutes he'd stand up and
no.
demand to proceed
Finally,
as though
when,
he had been a
when
lawyer.
The judge said sit down, he sat down and asked his question from a sitting position. And then the judge said bind and gag him, and I had this ultimate disgrace of watching a black man with all the symbolism of chains and gags being brought into the courtroom by four marshals, bound and gagged.
What would have made the difference if it had been a white man, for heaven's sakes? Don't be demagogic.
Well, maybe he wouldn't do it to a white man, Bill. That may be the difference.
Oh, come on. In the first place...
You say, come on.
Well, all right. Was it a black man or a white man in the state of Illinois who 2 months later, the Supreme Court judge said it was all right to go ahead and bind and gag him?
Yeah,
black
he,
or white?
He was
white.
He was white.
All right. So
but
get
you know
on.
What he was?
Change
he was
it.
An adjudicated lunatic. You don't mention that.
Yeah. This... adjudicated by a racist court?
I don't know. He had been
it's
held...
It's interesting when adjudications mean something.
I know the Mr. Allen against Illinois.
Yeah.
Allen had been adjudicated a lunatic. He stood up in front of the judge and tore up his file. He attempted to throw a chair. That's different than a man saying, I want to defend myself. Bobby didn't tear papers up or throw chairs.
But you're using very different arguments from what you use in Rochester, in which you denounce that decision as typical... please keep quiet. As typical of the Supreme Court, Supreme Court's insensitivity and of the forthcoming repression.
I didn't like the decision, Bill, because they used it to analogize it to areas where you didn't have adjudicated lunatics, and that's why I didn't like it.
Yeah.
I think it should be limited to its facts. I agree with it, limited to its facts.
Yeah, well, I suggest, Mr. Kunstler, that you have proved by suggesting that Mr. Hoffman is actually a racist, that he would do things to a black man that he wouldn't do to a white man, that you have not, number one, indulged the presumption of that man's innocence.
Oh, Judge Hoffman?
Certainly
he
not.
Wasn't on trial. The That's presumption of innocence was Bobby Seale's,
no,
you
find
judges.
It perfectly easy to denounce him as a racist, and all of a sudden you get very indignant because somebody said you said he was fascist. No, it wasn't you said he was fascist. It was your client who said you were fascist, and so on and so forth. And you try to have it always, every way. Now,
Bill, you make me indignant. You make me quivering. I haven't been doing any of these things. I'm not indignant if you pose an argument against me.
No,
it's legitimate and legal.
I don't care whether you are indignant.
I know you don't, but I never get really very indignant in these forensic interchanges.
Well, you were pretty indignant to start off with.
I'm firm,
yeah.
But firm doesn't mean indignant. I have firm positions and firm views.
Well, I believe in indignation.
Well, that may be.
Indignation is a necessary ingredient to true moral outrage.
Even indignation in the courtroom, right, Bill?
Subject to the rules.
Oh, subject
one
to the rules.
One often has to internalize indignation.
Well, I'm internalizing a little bit here.
Well, you're doing a moderately good job of it.
If you could look at the meter on my back, it's quivering slightly.
Well, but let me ask you this. Do you believe that the canon that says that lawyers must not engage in conduct that is prejudicial to the administration of justice, do you believe that canon should be repealed or not repealed?
Well, I think it should be interpreted in the light of what happens in any particular instance. If a judge says, for example, that Ramsey Clark, a former Attorney General of the United States, cannot even take the stand in front of the jury, mm-hmm. and that's called by the New York Times the ultimate outrage, mm-hmm. I think that there is a responsibility on lawyers to protest that visibly in the courtroom and to do it I don't like that, Your Honor, I object, Your Honor.
All right, what would you consider a not normal? What would you consider, under the circumstances, a legitimate way to express your displeasure?
I think to stand on
Burn down the building?
No. Did we burn down the Chicago courtroom?
No, you didn't, as a matter of fact. Right.
I'm glad you've got one admission out of you today.
Would you have condemned people who had?
Yes, I would have.
You would have?
I've already told
Why?
You what I feel Why? About burning.
Why? You just finished telling us that what happened in that trial room in Chicago was a marvelous expression of entrenched racism in this country. Now, if you can burn down a building because they have our ROTC drill there, why can't you burn down a building in which racism is practiced?
First of all, I didn't advocate even burning down a building with ROTC
drill. Do you condone arson, Mr. Kunstler? Yes.
Oh, but in certain circumstances.
Sure.
You don't like to put the end of that
question. This is a circumstance. This is a circumstance.
Bill, every time I've debated you
for the administration of racism
or Bill Rusher, out comes the Playboy interview. And it's all neatly underlined.
Sure.
And
memorized.
You use it memorized. Yeah. You use it for your purposes, but you never complete the paragraph.
Yes, I did.
Because you just admitted to me you believe in arson under certain circumstances.
No, I said it wasn't arson. I said it wasn't arson.
Oh, but you say it's legal to bomb and napalm babies.
I say that the purpose of war is to destroy the enemy. And if to destroy the enemy requires shooting him or burning him or dynamiting him or drowning him or putting poison ivy on him, the law does not distinguish between those means.
Bill, your arguments are really quite pathetic in the light of world history.
Oh, they are, really.
They are, because what you're doing is just your equations of poison ivy and napalm, just that kind of a juxtaposition shows that you have no real feeling for what's happening in Vietnam.
Mr. Kunstler, we both, you have fought in wars, and other people have fought in wars, and the answer is, of course, that wars are, by their nature, hideous. It's the most hideous activity that man can perform against man.
Yeah, but you just said it's legal.
You started a moment ago saying that you thought it was all right to use guns in self-defense. Now, I agree with you. We understand this to be a corporate act of self-defense.
I don't understand it to be a corporate act.
The United States, you're not the United States yet.
75% of the corporation doesn't like it.
That's not the point.
It's a corporate act by one-fourth of the corporation.
If you're saying that a lot of people would like to see the war over, I'm one of them. I'm in that 75%, by the way. Now, all I'm saying is that this particular war is being prosecuted and is being understood as an effort at self-defense.
And the use
of definitive instruments in a war like that is not something which we can have any control over so as to use only instruments that don't hurt. The purpose is not only to hurt, the purpose is to kill. Now, I'm distinguishing between that kind of activity and going down and burning any building in which an activity is engaged, which you disapprove of. What should I do, for instance, when people get elected to the Senate or the House of Representatives whom I don't like?
Bill, no one's out. You're creating your own nice straw man of burning down buildings and advocating it.
I've never advocated arson. You have.
I know, but you keep saying I advocate burning of buildings every time there's a disagreement. The very fact we didn't burn the courthouse in Chicago should prove to you.
What should prove to you?
That we don't use it.
If we ever
had good reason, we had it out there.
It proves to me. Ah.
Ah.
If you ever had good reason, you had it there. Now this.
Have I given you an opening?
Uh-huh. Tell me why it is that you have told the students that if their demands are not met, they should burn down a building. Why should they be more indignant at that building than you are against that Chicago
courtroom? That isn't quite what I said. I gave a step from plateau to plateau people could do.
All right. And answered, you cannot, yes. If a point has been reached in a given situation where the mechanisms of society are not responding to serious grievances. Now, suppose some people say, well, I don't like ROTC. Mechanisms of society, where are you? Do something about the fact that, and suppose ROTC continues. All right, then the mechanisms of society haven't responded to serious grievances, so I should go and burn down the building.
Well, it's not quite that simple. I would like to give it to you the way the Berrigans see it, because the Berrigan brothers and the people that went to Catonsville, Maryland with them to burn draft records put it on a very different kind of a plateau. They said that you try everything, and they did for 5-6 long years. They started with the simple thing, mm-hmm. voting, going to congressmen, going to Fort Myers, demonstrations. And when they found that all else had failed them, mm-hmm. they took some homemade napalm and took out 500 or so 1A draft files out of a draft board in Catonsville, Maryland, put them on a parking lot where no one could be hurt, poured the napalm over them, and burnt them.
Yeah.
And that progression is what I think personified the Revolutionary War, the fight against slavery in
this
country.
Now they're in jail. Now they're in jail.
They're in jail. Price was executed.
So, and you're saying what?
I'm saying that that type of a...
Well, now suppose he weren't in jail.
Well, you ask me what I'm saying, and then you won't let me say it.
What's the next step? What's the next step?
Well, the next step, the long step, might be revolution someday. Who knows?
Suppose the Barrackans are not given the State Department to preside over. What do they do after
that? They don't
next?
Ask for the State
Department. You like this progression. Now, where do you stop?
I guess
napalm over the files. How about then, let's say, blowing up the Empire State Building?
No, they take the position that anything...
Or is there a step in between?
Right. No, they take the position anything short of revolution that might injure a human being should not be done. That's why they took the files out of the building and put it on an empty parking lot. That's the whole step they took. They don't want any human being hurt. And I don't want any human being hurt. If there is a revolution, then, of course, these rules won't apply. Yeah. The revolutions are bloody.
Yeah.
Unfortunately.
And the time to revolt has not come.
I don't think it has come.
Uh-huh. Mr. Tybee.
Yes. We're talking about the role of the lawyer in the American system of jurisprudence. And you mentioned several canons with which lawyers are charged to practice their profession.
This is a question of me or...
Yes, of you.
Yeah.
Would you at least admit of the possibility that the legal profession, along with several other professions, is changing its allegiance from its client or money, which is what it is, to their moral convictions? Is that a possibility?
I think it is happening. In point of fact, Mr. Kunstler has defended that, and he was very rigorously rejected in the American Law Journal, rejected on the grounds that if you insist that you be morally concerned with the case that you press, you are not providing professional services to people whom you may not be sympathetic with.
Well, that's precisely because the law profession for 100 years has told its students that your first allegiance is to your client.
That's
and it's
right.
Only now with people like Mr. Nader and perhaps Mr. Kunstler who are saying that my first responsibility isn't to my client, isn't to make money, isn't to satisfy his cause, but my cause, a moral conviction.
Well, that's interesting. I quoted from Canon that was, your specific question is this changing?
Yes.
I quoted you from a canon that was codified and passed on the 1st of January, 1970. So I'm not quoting Blackstone or anything.
By the establishment bar, I might add. What he quotes from is the American Bar Association.
I think you got to have rules.
Their editorial.
Sure. I think you got to have rules. I think I can understand a doctor saying, I refuse to take out your appendix. I think you're antisocial. But I would say that it would be unwise to change the Hippocratic Oath in that way.
It's funny that you should defend the system of jurisprudence now, while at the same time in some of your columns you chastise the courts for the imposition they place on, say, Roy Cohn in his case. What an awful imposition it is.
I don't think they should be persecuted. Prosecuted are different. Persecuted. I don't believe in persecution. I don't believe that because somebody decides that he dislikes you, he should devote the rest of his time to try to put you in jail and to indulge people who are willing to testify against you.
Is it an historical possibility, though, that blacks, perhaps long-haired people, college students, have been severely persecuted and regularly persecuted by the courts?
How can you persecute somebody more than making them slaves?
That's true.
They've been enslaved. All of us have been enslaved at one point or another, blacks and whites. The history of black slavery is just a sand in the beach of time. There isn't any race in the world that has
been. So that it should be allowed to continue.
Tell that to black people.
It should be allowed to continue?
Of course not.
No.
Why do you conclude that? I just resent the fact that people suggest that only black people have been slaves.
I'll tell you this. They're one of the few groups of people who have been enslaved, who have been dehumanized by the process.
No, that's not true.
Well, that is true.
Look at the suffering of the Jews, for God's sake. The Jews weren't allowed to vote in England until 1840.
Yeah.
So,
the Jews weren't lynched from Alabama trees.
Well, they weren't in Alabama, but they would have been if they had been.
Well,
The Ku Klux Klan, my friends, was not only an anti-black organization, but also anti-Jewish and also anti-Catholic.
I know, but the black slavery is a far different matter than any other type that I know of.
Mr. Kunstler, I'd like to address my question to you. You are advocating that people use their own conscience as their guide in terms of interpreting the law. What I'd like to know is how, or what kind of a, what kind of a society is able to exist without some sort of a common law.
You asked me that I advocate people using their own consciences as their guides, and then you say, does that, what you're really saying, does that really preclude a society of laws existing? It does not. I think people should act on their own consciences. And normally you'll find most consciences are in tune. There are usually millions of people who share the same feelings about murder, war, arson, racism, genocide, etc.
Well, if someone doesn't.
Feeling. People who feel strongly in their own conscience, then if it is strong enough and if they find enough support, will act upon their conscience. That doesn't mean they violate every law. Most people obey most laws. In 1859, let me finish this. In 1859, Oberlin College students went and freed a fugitive slave who had been apprehended under the Fugitive Slave Act, a very legitimate legal act of the Congress of the United States, coming out of the Compromise of 1854. And they were all prosecuted, and their defense was their conscience should take precedence. And the prosecution was dropped. In many states, we have a rule of law. In Maryland, where I'm trying a case now, they have a rule of law that the jury is the judge of the law. They can judge the law on their own conscience.
So then
conscience
you advocate
is not
that
something that's mutually exclusive with law.
Mm-hmm. So that you advocate if someone does firmly believe that he should break the law, then he should. Now, if this happens...
Now that doesn't mean he's going out to rob a delicatessen store. We're talking about things now. I don't want you to pull a Buckley on me and make a, you know...
No, I wouldn't pull it.
All right.
Well, what, do you advocate any form of punishment for a person that would go against the law if he firmly believed that he was doing the right thing?
Well, there are existing punishments.
Well, I'm
the
Berrigans, existing. I'm
as
talking
Bill
about your
pointed
own
out,
ideas,
are in jail.
Because you don't seem to agree with any existing things. I'm asking about yourself.
What, for whether I agree that it should be punishment?
Yeah.
I think society has a right to punish if it prosecutes legitimately, and I think there are some legitimate prosecutions.
Like
I see
what?
Nothing wrong with punishment. The individual has to make a determination whether he submits to the punishment or goes underground. Out of the Catonsville Nine, one, Mary Moylan, went underground. That was a political decision, and she is still underground, apparently. Dan Berrigan decided not to submit to punishment and went around the country popping up under the nose of the FBI from time to time in pulpit or television studio. Phil Berrigan sought sanctuary here in New York in St. Gregory's. They were apprehended, the last two, and now they're being punished. But that, I am not saying that they shouldn't be punished. That's mm-hmm. part of society's laws.
Mr. Harvey.
Hey, Mr. Buckley, you are very interested and very concerned about the legality of things.
Mm-hmm.
That things should be done legally to provide, I suppose, order in society. Now, you have also indicated that violence, legally prosecuted, is admissible. And therefore, a government is admissible. And that, therefore, a government which prosecutes...
No, I didn't say that. I didn't say that.
Well, for example, take, for example, your discussion of Hiroshima.
Yeah.
It was legally correct,
and
it was proper that the United States bomb Hiroshima.
Yeah.
And from your consideration that governments which prosecute violence legally should be endorsed, I would take it that if you had lived in Germany during the 30s and the 40s, you have endorsed the Nazi regime.
No.
Why not? They were legally constituted.
Because what one has to distinguish in a situation in which one is asked to identify oneself with a country that is engaged in certain kinds of activity. I distinguish between the country that says, I'm going to war because I want to enslave the whole of Europe and in the course of it exterminate all the Jews, and a country that says, I'm going to war to keep them from doing that.
Now, Mr. Buckley, take,
that's
for example,
isn't it?
We have the Constitution of the United States.
Yeah.
Okay,
nice.
And complicated and illogical.
Yes. And I'd like to ask you, with the publication of the Pentagon documents by not only the New York Times, but a number of other newspapers, do you believe that those newspapers were right in publishing those documents?
I think it's a complicated case and impossible to say, because one doesn't know what lies in the balance of those documents. There, as we sit here, the courts are trying to decide whether to permit them to be published. What it is a rather typical test case between two provisions of the Constitution, which if you extend them simultaneously, they bump into each other. The freedom of the press on the one hand, and the right of the government on the other hand to conduct itself other than in a glass house.
Is it significant that you didn't mention anything about that in your column on the Times case? You called it merely a political operation, nothing to do with the First Amendment or anything else.
I think it is political.
A political operation?
Yes, I do, yes. That's my own feeling about it.
Yeah.
But it is not being treated by the courts as a political operation, obviously. They have to address themselves with constitutional issues.
Oh, I see. Yeah.
Well, it seems to me that you talk about political issues, too, you know, the courts. And political issues are not unknown to the courts.
Isn't
political motivation?
Well, no, you talk about motivation. I mean,
isn't the law
they might be motivated by love or hatred or politics or whatever, but we're talking about the issues as they have been brought before.
I know, but issues are frequently colored by politics. That's all I'm suggesting.
They are frequently colored by everything.
That's true.
Anything else to impart tonight?
I think I've done my bit.
I was going to ask, isn't the law, the legal system, merely a framework to make politics more humane and less barbaric?
I think that's a good statement, a good way of putting it. As I understand the law, it is an attempt to arrive at a series of rules on the basis of which people can live together.
So you believe that if groups take advantage of the legal system, then other groups have the right to, let's for example, to make it more clear, governments use the legal system to prosecute barbarities. Then the citizenry do have a right to promote civil disobedience.
It doesn't follow. I don't see why it would follow from that.
Well, you said yourself that when the Nazis set out to exterminate the Jews mm-hmm. and conquer all of Europe, that you would not have endorsed that.
No, I think that when you have an unfree society, and there is no room for dissent, there is no opportunity to vote out the tyrant. Then, classically and defensively, you get a situation in which regicide is not only permitted, but in some cases enjoined.
Mr. Buckley, I have a question.
Excuse me.
That just requires a yes or no answer.
Sure.
It seems to me that you defend the law when it's expedient to your purposes. You characterized Roy Cohn as the prosecutor's Moby Dick.
Mm-hmm.
Roy Cohn was an investigative aide to the late Senator Joseph McCarthy. There was nothing you said that the prosecutor wouldn't do in order to get Roy Cohn, to get a conviction on Roy Cohn. Was not Alger Hiss Richard Nixon's Moby Dick, and are not the Black Panthers or the innocent among the 12,000
no.
in Washington
the
also
answer is no.
the government's Moby Dick?
The answer is no, he wasn't.
Why not?
Well, because Alger Hiss was found guilty by a court of law, not by Richard Nixon. Richard Nixon had absolutely nothing to do with the prosecution once the law case was tried.
Once it was tried.
Sure. Yes. He wasn't in charge. He wasn't a U.S. attorney. He wasn't the guy who was saying drop everything and so on and so forth.
What about the other example, the innocent among the 12,000 who were arrested in Washington and incarcerated and left with records? So burdened. Are they not? Will the government not do anything to get them? They certainly did. They corralled them. They sweep
them off the streets. I can't think of an instance in history in which there was less bloodlust than there. They took them and they stuck them away for about 5 hours and forgot about them. They didn't even fingerprint them, prosecute them. So I shouldn't think that would be a very good example of the kind of thing that
yeah,
I think.
But Bill, remember, if they can do it for 5 hours, the next time it may be for 5 years. Concentration camps in Germany didn't spring up overnight, and freedoms weren't lost overnight. What I think he's suggesting, and what I'm suggesting to you, is there is a gradual accumulation of tyranny that you cannot forget for a moment.
Thank you, Mr. Kunstler. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, members of the panel.
A printed copy of this program, send 25 cents in coin, no stamps please, to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29205. That's 25 cents to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29205. This program was made possible by a grant from the Corporation for Public Broadcasting.